Today we're going to be talking about ice. That's why I'm wearing this giant coat. Which is kind of ridiculous because technically I'm inside, so... You know what? No, I don't want to do the whole video wearing a coat. I'm just gonna put it down here. It just like that. It was a good idea visually. It would have worked well, but yeah, that would have gotten really hot for me. We're talking about ice. You know ice. What happens to water when it freezes at 0 degrees Celsius here on the surface of the Earth? Horatio asked me, can ice be frozen further when exposed to colder temperatures? And are there different kinds of ice? That is a great question, Horatio. Well, my first instinct is to say, no, don't be ridiculous. Ice is ice. Once it becomes ice, where is there to go from there? But just to cover my bases, let me do a quick Google search. Ice forms. What? So yeah, I was totally wrong. There are 17 different kinds of ice that scientists know about. 17. Okay, so there's three phases of matter, right? Solid, like ice, liquid, like water, and gas, like steam or water vapor. Good old H2O occupies all three of these phases where we live here on Earth, but that's because we live at a certain pressure and a certain temperature range. Now, temperature, you probably already know about. Sometimes it's hot outside, sometimes it's cold, but pressure's another thing to think about. We're under pressure from the air in our atmosphere. Now, you don't think about it often because we're so used to it. So used to it that, in fact, we can't live without that pressure. Now, where does this pressure come from? It comes from the atmosphere. We're actually at the bottom of a giant ocean of air. How much pressure are we under? 101,325 pascals, or 101,325 newtons of force per square meter. Or a much easier measurement, 1 atmosphere. Cool, that's an easy way to think about it, but more on that later. So back to ice. Depending on the temperature and the pressure, ice can form in different ways. These different ices are numbered with Roman numerals. So there's ice 1, which is the ice we know about, ice 2, ice 3, ice 4, and so on, all the way up to ice 17 and a few bonus ices in between. So how do we come across these interesting ices and what are they? Well, that's easy. Just look at this simple to understand chart. Yeah, great, thanks. That clears everything up, no problem. I mean, really? So yeah, let's break this chart down a little bit. This is a phase diagram. Basically, it describes what phase water will be in depending on the temperature, which is colder over here, hotter over here, and the pressure, lower pressure, higher pressure. But let's get rid of some of this crazy information and clean the place up a bit. Okay, there, that's good. So here we are at about 1 atmosphere of pressure and around, say, 20 degrees Celsius. And hey, look, it says right here, water would be liquid. Yep, that checks out. Over here is 0 degrees Celsius, you know, where water freezes to ice. And over here is 100 degrees Celsius, where water turns into steam. So here's the regular ice we're used to. Ice 1, H. Well, H stands for hexagonal, because the H2O molecules align themselves into a hexagonal structure, or a six-sided shape. And that's the ice you know and love. The ice that you build snowmen out of, that you freeze into cubes to cool down your lemonade, or the ice that falls from the sky in the form of snow. Interesting fact, the reason why snowflakes have six sides is because of that hexagonal structure that the molecules form. Right? Cool. I mean, cool, yeah. That's the only time I'm gonna make that cool joke. Just that one time. All right, now let's take another look at this chart. Could this chart be any more confusing? Okay, so these are the different kinds of ice. And if you don't know how to count in Roman numerals yet, it can be a little confusing. And if you do know how to count in Roman numerals, it's also confusing because they aren't in order. Because the ices are numbered in the order they were discovered, not in, you know, a way that would make this chart any easier to understand. But let's dive in. We've got ice 1, both 1H and 1C apparently, but we'll get to that in a minute. Ice 2 and 3. Ice 4 isn't on the chart, but it overlaps here. 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, and 11. Wait, 11 hexagonal and 11 orthorhombic. And orthorhombic. All right. Well, there are other kinds of ices that aren't even on this chart, but let's not confuse it anymore. We'll just stick to the ones that we've got right now. Now, it's got lots of really cool different kinds of ices to choose from, and I want to see one. I want to feel one. I want to hold it in my hand. Well, that's going to be difficult, and here's why. Most of us live at a pressure around sea level, or one atmosphere. We call it sea level because that's pretty much as low as you can go in the atmosphere. We're at the bottom, and a whole atmosphere is pressing down on us. Now, most of us live somewhere close to one atmosphere, but if you go up higher, like in the mountains, there's less atmosphere above you pressing down, so you have less pressure. The highest altitude city, El Alto, Bolivia, is at 4,000 meters, 4 kilometers above sea level. When you get that high, the pressure of the atmosphere is about 0.6 of normal. So let's say that humans are comfortable in pressures anywhere from 0.6 to 1 atmosphere. Now, let's talk about temperature. Regular day-to-day temperatures in places that humans generally live go from maybe minus 40 degrees Celsius if you live in a place that has really cold winters to plus 40 degrees Celsius if you live in a place that has really hot summers. So let's put all of those extremes on our chart. 0.6 atmospheres of pressure to 1 atmosphere of pressure, and minus 40 degrees Celsius to plus 40 degrees Celsius in temperature. Wow, we're in a tiny box on this chart. We aren't even close to any of the other ices. Man, can't get any other kinds of ice on Earth? Well, actually you can. In the high atmosphere, in the clouds, it does get cold enough temperatures for instead of ice 1 to form, you get ice 1. Yeah, but it's still called ice 1, but 1H stands for hexagonal and 1C stands for cubic. It means the crystals will grow a little differently, but they're still the same from a molecular level, and by the time it falls from the cloud, it's back to good old regular 1H again. So, where do we have to go to see these other kinds of ice? Well, some can be made in a lab, freezing things or putting them in under more pressure. The other place we could go to find these different kinds of ice is space! This is Ganymede, one of Jupiter's moons. But don't be fooled by the word moon. It's actually bigger than Mercury. In fact, it's the largest moon in the solar system. And it's made up of a lot of water. Scientists think there's a dense shell of ice on the outside that could protect an entire ocean of liquid water underneath. Now, Ganymede deserves its own video, and if I ever make one, I will link it below. And if I haven't yet, reach out to my question hub, also linked below, and tell me to, you know, get on it. Anyway, because it would be cold and under a lot of pressure, scientists think that Ganymede and other icy moons might have lots of ice too. All right, ice too. So, what would ice too look like? Well, the different ices mostly have to do with how the H2O molecules arrange themselves. They form different kinds of crystal structures. Ice too doesn't make a hexagonal crystal structure. It makes one called rhombohedral, which, you know, doesn't help us visualize it much. But maybe it might look like dolomite, which also has a rhombohedral crystal structure. Huh? That's pretty cool, right? Okay, ice 5. Ice 5 is ice 2 at just higher temperatures. And if you go right down into the core of Ganymede, you'd find hundreds of kilometers of ice 5. Now, what does it look like? Well, it's got a monoclinic crystal structure, which looks like this. I mean, come on, seriously, that's not giving me anything. I have no idea. All right, anyway, here's a crystal called orthocase, which has the same crystal structure as ice 5. There, that's something we can work with. We can visualize that a little bit better. Now, if you go to Europa, another of Jupiter's moons, you'd find another planet where there might be an entire water ocean below the surface. I mean, it also needs a whole video. But the floor of that ocean, possibly ice 7. It would have a cubic crystal structure, like the crystal pyrite. The cool thing about ice 7 is not only could it exist at room temperature, but it's still ice all the way along. 350 degrees, yep, still ice. Why? Because under so much pressure, anywhere from 1,000 atmospheres of pressure to 100,000 atmospheres of pressure. But we've actually found Ice 7 on Earth. Scientists have found little pockets of Ice 7 in diamonds. Now, in case you didn't know how to get a diamond, you take some coal and you crush it under incredible pressure deep in the earth for a really long time. So the coal turns to diamond and water turns to Ice 7. Haha, neat. And now to actually answer Horatio's question. If you take ice and freeze it more, what will happen? Well, here you go. If you just had a really good freezer, one that you can turn the temperature way down, you could freeze water into ice 1H at 0 degrees Celsius. Then at minus 100, it would turn into ice 1C, which we talked about. And if you keep going to minus 200 degrees Celsius, you get ice 11. The molecules change shape and would grow in a different crystal structure. Here's a picture of aragonite, which has the same crystal structure as ice 11. Cool. I mean, really cool.
Yeah, I know. I wasn't supposed to make that joke again, and I totally did.
Unfortunately, I looked it up, and the freezer you have at home only goes down to about minus 18 degrees at the very best, so you'd probably have to go to a science lab to get anything like that. So, there you go, Horatio, a brief glimpse into the different kinds of ice. Thank you so much for your question. If you have a really awesome science question to ask me, well, please do. Just click the link below and that will take you to the awesome science question hub. What is it? It's probably just Facebook, but you know, you never know. It could be like, you know, in the future I could create some, you know, really elaborate website, but yeah, it's probably just Facebook for the time being. Ask me some cool questions, hit like and subscribe, and in the meantime, stay curious.